With our whole heart, soul, We have myself. So I need you to pray for me that I don't stay up here all day. Amen. I see somebody praying already. Persons who find themselves in some individual encounters with the master in the Bible. In the Bible, this just happens to be one of my favorite stories. I want you to open your Bibles and keep them open. Look at verses 6 and 7 with me, if you will, of the gospel according to John, the 4th chapter, because it tells us that it was on a hot summer's day when the Samaritan woman came to draw water from the well. And more specifically, verse 6 says that it was in the heat of the day, around high noon, when the path of this Samaritan woman crossed paths with the Savior, who is wonderful. John is setting the stage for what is about to happen by shining the spotlight on the nature of Jesus that so often goes unnoticed. But please notice in verse 7 that the woman came with her water pitcher to draw water from Jacob's well. When she ran into Jesus, the one who is water when you thirst. Now, I wonder, do I have any witnesses out there? One who will change your life and rearrange your priorities. And this text proves the point that once again, you can be going along doing your normal routine, doing the same thing at the same time. You can be doing what you've always done. Yeah. And the Bible tells us, even in this story, that Sister Girl was doing what she had always done before. And we've seen this before, that you can be going along doing your normal routine, yeah, when the Lord will position himself to bless you beyond your wildest dreams. Yeah. Verse 7, look at it. She was in the middle of her daily duty. She found herself, in a wonderful exchange with the Master Jesus. Look at it. She is not at a religious ceremony. She is not standing around in a crowd where they're being fed with a few fish and a few loaves of bread. There are no miracles being performed. There's no water being turned into wine. There are no demons being cast out. She is in the midst of her normal routine. No one is walking on water. No one is raised from the dead. It's just her going about her normal routine when the Lord had already positioned himself to bless her beyond her wildest dreams. And that's just how the Lord works. Come on, say, that's how the Lord works. Look at your text. Jesus was already at the well when she approached the well with one thing on her mind, and that was to fill her water pitcher with the cool water from Jacob's well. And the Bible tells us in verse 8 that the Lord's disciples had gone into a nearby town to buy some groceries. I love it. This woman and Jesus found himself alone at the well. Now, I can't speak for you, but some of my best moments have come when I've spent some alone time with God. Just me and Jesus, me and God, all alone. It doesn't matter. It can be in the noonday hour, or as our ancestors would say, late in the midnight hour, down on bended knees in a prayer closet with a closed door in your office, in your car. You can be all alone with God, and God will show up and bless you beyond your wildest dream. The Bible teaches that sometimes God can only reveal certain things to you when you spend some alone time with God. Now, if God has revealed something to you lately, then maybe you need to do like that song that we sang, you ought to steal away and spend some alone time with God. You understand that? One songwriter said, I come to the garden alone, while what the dew is still on the roses. I love that song. The songwriter said, and the voice I hear falling on my ear. In fact, what does the chorus say? The chorus said, what? He walked with me. Now, this is personal. He talks with me. This is personal. He tells me that I am his own. And look, and the journey shared. Oh, you ought to spend some alone time with me. As you tell me that no other has ever known. I love the second stanza, because the second stanza said, while I'm alone with you, he speaks to me. And the sound of his voice is so sweet that the birds hush their singing, and the melody he gave to me is still ringing. I love it. In the midst of all the things that you have to do, you ought to mark on your calendar today to spend some alone time with the Christ. Now, spend some time with him and see what a difference he will make in your life. See, up others may have shunned this Samaritan woman, but Jesus wanted to save her. Others may have treated her like an object, but Jesus talked to her like she was a subject. I love it. Other men may have talked to her on a physical level, but Jesus is talking to her on a spiritual level. And by all means, let me point out in this story, look at verse 17. I'm coming back to our primary text in just a moment, but look at verse 17. The Bible says that this sister had tried on multiple occasions to get her human relationships in order. Well, I'm in the text. Look at it. Verse 17 says, she tried, but she failed in her trying. Verse 18 says, she tried five times, and the verdict was still out on number six. Look at it. That's what Jesus said. The one you're with now. Look at it. You see how the Lord can get all up in your Kool-Aid? Look at it. She tried, but she failed five times. And let me tell you something. What the Lord has shown me about failure, what he's taught me about life. Sometimes the Lord will show up right in the midst of your failure to turn your failure into success. Yeah. Somebody missed that. Let me say that again. Sometimes the Lord will show up right in the midst of your failure to turn your failure into success. And then the years have taught me that you can't get those other relationships in order until you get your God relationship in order.
That's right.
Hello. Can I find amen right about that?
Yeah.
But y'all know what we do, don't you? You know what we do? We go after all the other relationships. Now, please don't sit there like you don't know what I'm talking about. Huh? We want to have them other relationships first. Then we want to work on our God relationship. But when you get your God relationship in order, God will order your steps in all those other relationships, especially when you spend some alone time with him. You can watch and witness him turn your life upside down and take you to a whole new level, just like he did for this woman in our text. Come on, look closer with me to this thing for just a few more minutes. Then I'm going to look at this. Look, I don't want you to miss this. Look, sister girl's life gets lifted to a brand new level. Because she found out that there was more than water in the wonderful well of the Waymaker. This sister, this woman who had come to the well to draw water, has a conversation with the Christ, and it appears that she didn't realize the privilege that she had. It appeared that she didn't realize the opportunity of the blessing that was waiting for her right there in our midst. Here sitting, look at verse 6, was the promised one of Israel. Here sitting was the hope of all humanity. Sitting at the well was the one who carried in his heart a mission, the one who upon his shoulders was the task of human redemption. She didn't know how this alone time with Jesus would impact and change her life for the good. Look at the text. John records in verse 6 that Jesus was sitting there quietly and patiently as if he was waiting just for her. Somebody missed that. That there are no accidental needs with God. Heaven moves intentionally. Heaven moves purposefully. Heaven moves patiently. Heaven moves powerfully. Things just don't happen without any forethought from God. Go back and read Genesis chapter 1. All you will find straddled across the creation process is the order of God, the purposeful intention of God. And sometimes his purpose is to teach us patience. He is a purposeful God, and you and I were put here for a purpose. And the Bible teaches that sometimes it's during those alone times that we discover what that purpose is. Now look at verse 7. As the woman prepared to draw water, Jesus asked her for a drink. The Bible says she apparently was surprised. She looked startled by the fact that he would even speak to her. And it says that she could tell that he was not a Samaritan. Maybe it was his accent. Maybe it was his apparel, the way he was dressed. Or maybe it was his afro. Somebody will get that on the way home. But it was something about his appearance that made her take notice of the fact that he was not a Samaritan, but he was a Galilean Jew. And history records that the Jewish people had nothing to do with the Samaritan people. They dated back some 722 years before Jesus was born. There was this prevailing And we don't like y'all fighting like that, tit for tat, get on back. The Jews disliked the Samaritans so bad, the Bible says, that they wouldn't even set foot on the soil of one another. And for centuries, the Judeans and the Samaritans coexisted side by side within the same land, but the relationship was strained at best, but openly hostile at worst. And the geography of Palestine made it possible for them to avoid one another. In fact, if I were to leave, if I were to take a direct route from here to Atlanta, but because I had a problem with the folk in Macon, Georgia, instead of going up I-75, you know what I would do? I would take I-95. Now, you know that's way out of the way. Somebody's still listening. How many of you know folk who go way out of their way to avoid folk that they don't like?
Yeah.
Okay, I just stumbled up on something before. We would go out of our way to avoid folk. Somebody please help us.
Yeah.
Some of us would go out of our way just to avoid folk that we don't want to fool with. We're in the text. And the Jews would take an alternative route to avoid the Samaritans. They would rather take a travel route that took them twice as long rather than take a direct route. But what I love about Jesus, look at verse 4. The Jews would take a detour, but Jesus would be more direct. Verse 4, Jesus said, what? I must go through Samaria. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth. And the thing about truth, truth does not ponder a pet. Truth does not wander away, but truth is direct. Jesus said, I must go through Samaria. Jesus is direct in his work. He doesn't get sidetracked by long-standing controversy. He doesn't waste time on pettiness. He understands that life is too short, and he understands that it's too short for hesitation or procrastination. And when you consider all that he accomplished in 3 years, then you witness a Savior who was on a mission, on a direct path to engage in a task of redemption. And just for a few more moments, let me show you what that looked like when this woman took a drink from the water of the well of Jesus. Come on, turn to your verse 19. Tell us that there's more than water in his well. She responds to Jesus' request of give me some water. Look at it. She starts out by interjecting race and religion. Please notice, when she interjects race and religion, Jesus introduces a path to a relationship. So often what this Samaritan woman in our text demonstrated is that we too often let the things of the past hold us hostage when it comes to our relationships in the present. We can't get to what God has for us in the present because we're too busy holding on to things from the past. And she says in verse 9, how can you, a Jew, that's religion, how can you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a Samaritan, that's race? In other words, she's saying, have you no regard for the social norms of our day, Jesus? Have you no regard for the historical attitudes? Where is your sense of propriety? Don't you understand the consequences of stepping outside the lines of tradition? Don't you realize that our people don't get along? We're not even supposed to speak to one another. Don't you realize, because your grandmama didn't get along with my grandmother, your granddad didn't see eye to eye with my granddad, we're not supposed to trust one another. Don't you understand, Jesus, that if you live on the west side, we're not supposed to like each other on the east side. We're not supposed to love one another. Does any of this sound familiar? Huh? Don't you realize that because I'm Baptist and you're Methodist, we're not supposed to relate to one another. Because you're black and because I'm white, we're not supposed to have the same rights. We're not supposed to sit on the same bus. We're not supposed to drink from the same water. Now, we're not supposed to walk on the same sidewalk. We're not supposed to attend the same school. Don't you realize that the Samaritans and the Jews are not even supposed to speak to one another? And here you are asking me for a drink of water. This woman responded the only way she knew how. But when you read this story, I love the response that Jesus gave. Look, he never let society set his standards. He didn't let tradition color his truth. He didn't allow geography to get in the way of his destiny. I love it. He said, I must go through Samaria. And it was that decision that ended up making a difference in the life of this Samaritan. blessed one who came to draw water from Jacob's well, which was temporal. But she ended up drinking from Jesus' well that was eternal. And look at what this encounter did in the life of this Samaritan woman. Three things. I'm going to give it to you and I'm going to do three quick observations. Write them down. Look at it. The first one I just gave to you a moment ago. Look, the obvious lesson. The first thing Jesus did was to change the atmosphere. Look at it. He changed the atmosphere by the way that he talked to her, which in essence ended up changing her attitude. Look at it. The Samaritan woman, watch this in verse 9, wanted to interject religion and race into the atmosphere. But the Lord Jesus changed the atmosphere and introduced a relationship. As a matter of fact, Jesus never addressed the religion matter. He never addressed the race matter. Jesus is talking about a relationship. Verse 10, Jesus said, if you knew who this was, I wonder if I have anybody out there who knows who the Lord is, who the relationship is. I wonder if I have any good or believers out there this morning. Come on, y'all, give God some praise right now. You know that you know that you know that.
Anybody who's ran into the Lord, who's down now.
he speaks to.
Yeah.
This woman leaves the well with a new talk.
Yeah.
She leaves the well with a new walk. I heard somebody say, he'll give you a new reason for living. He'll give you a hope for your hope. Yes. He'll give you a new heart. Yes. He'll give you a new joy. He'll give you new courage. He'll give you new patience. He'll give you a new revelation. He'll give you a new commitment. He'll give you a new understanding. He'll give you a new strength. He'll give you a new vision. He'll put a new soul in your heart. How can the Lord change you? He can change the atmosphere. He can change your attitude. He can change your action. He can change your attitude. Look, if there's anything you give the Lord to do, He can change you. If anybody the Lord has ever changed, step into your situation. Step into your circumstances and change it. Like the songwriter says, such a wonderful change has come over me. Has the Lord changed in your life? This woman who came with her water pitcher. The Bible says she left and went running with a testimony. She came with the task, but she left with the testimony. And that's how the Lord works. You can be doing your normal routine, and He'll show up. Show out and bless you in a way that will change your life forever. This woman said, come, see a man. A man who can cheer you, a man who can change you, but he's also a man who will challenge you to live your life according to his will, according to his way, and to his word. Has the Lord changed anybody? We sang the song as his antique feet that says a wonderful change has come over me.
Thank you.
This is my body, which is broken for you. After which he took the cup represented the blood, which was shed, and then Jesus said, take the drink.
Give to Yeah, it has been outside, cut it some.